So good evening, good afternoon, good morning to people from different parts of the world. And it is my privilege to welcome you as coordinator of GENSA, which is a special interest group of the Community of Evaluators South Asia. And that includes, of course, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. So as part of our Gender and Equity Network South Asia, we are hosting an expert lecture by Dr. Hafisa Khatun from Bangladesh. We are very excited to have you here today, Dr. Khatun. It is our pleasure to welcome you. GENSA's dedicated team of volunteers has been working very hard behind the scenes to provide quality, thought-provoking content for our membership. And they're going to take us through today's session. So may I invite Bijita to take over.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sonal. We are indeed excited about this expert lecture. But before we begin, we know that some of you here are joining us for the first time. So I would like to invite my colleague Alpakshi to give us a quick glimpse of who we are. Over to you, Alpakshi.
Thanks, Bijita. Welcome, everyone. As Sonal has already mentioned, GENSA, Gender and Equity Network South Asia, is a network of evaluators based in South Asia that seek to focus on evaluations with a gender focus using the unique experiences of the South Asian context. We want to make this a buzzing network through hosting events like this one, our first expert lecture. In August, we hosted our inaugural skill building coffee break session on social network analysis. And going forward, we plan to organize many more such events. In case you are interested in any topic or issue or would like to present or organize, please write to us at gensanetwork@gmail.com. We would also like to hear back more from you at the same email ID. The email ID will also be provided in the chat box. Thank you, everyone, and have a great session. Over to you, Bijita.
Thank you, Alpakshi, for that introduction to our network. At this point, let's take a quick poll to set the context. The poll question, please. I hope you all are taking a moment to answer that question. Right, so can we see the poll results, Kriti? Great, so okay, that's interesting. Quite a lot of you, actually 38% almost, have heard about, you've heard about it, but you would like to know more, which is excellent. And almost 62% of you have never heard about it, which is also good news for all of us. So thank you so much for taking that poll and for those responses. I'm sure today's session here will help us dig deeper into this topic. So let me now request all the members to please mute your audio and video and post your concerns, comments, queries in the chat box below. And we will take them up towards the end of this session. Now, without further ado, may I request Mr. Zain Haidari, board member from Pakistan Evaluation Association, to introduce our guest speaker for the day. Mr. Zain himself has over 5 years of experience in designing and conducting evaluations, including in fragile and extremely complex contexts. He has extensive experience in a variety of thematic areas, including but not limited to health, gender, women's economic empowerment, education, and civic rights. Over to you, Zain.
Thank you, Vijita. Good evening, everyone. Well, today I have the pleasure to introduce Dr. Hafisa Khatun, who is a human geographer with a number of specializations, including social, population, gender, and urban geography, as well as disaster management. Dr. Khatun, you were born in old Dhaka, Bangladesh, and are currently a professor of geography and environment. You are a former director of the Disaster Research Training and Management Center and a former chairperson of the Department of Geography and Environment at the University of Dhaka. You have served as part-time professor at Burke University and Bangladesh University of Professionals. You also designed and taught management of land acquisition, resettlement and rehabilitation, disaster management and environmental management. You hold 40 years of teaching and research experience and have supervised more than 70 researches at postgraduate level. You have worked on more than 150 development projects with various development partners. You are the author of 80 academic articles and have also written and edited 9 books, including 2 on gender geography published at national and international level. You are an editor of 3 journals and you are also a member on the editorial board of 2 other journals. You earned your BA honors in geography and MA in population geography from Jahangir Nagar University. You also earned MA in urban geography from the University of Alberta, Canada, and a PhD in anthropogeography from the University of Dhaka. Thank you. Over to you, Vijita.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that introduction, Zen. I totally hand this over to you now, Dr. Khatun. Please take over.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to talk. This is the first talk in JENSA, I should say the expert lecture. I'm so privileged to be here. And so, yeah, this is good evening from Bangladesh, but as because the, I hope audiences are from all over the world, so we cannot mention any time. So this is geography, you see, time and space, where we are locating and in regards of time. So here I will, and just I will go to the my presentation. Okay, just a minute. Where it is? Yeah. So you are all welcome to my, you know, first lecture. So I hope I can make some, you know, grace or some question within yourself so you can ask me, so I can answer. So then I can understand what I didn't tell you. Maybe I this was with me. So as a teacher, I want to tell everything what I know. So here that you see the title, Gender Geography, Learnings and Challenges.
Akisachi, can you put it on the slideshow? So we have the full screen.
Oh, sure.
Thank you.
Okay. So you see the Gender Geography, Learnings and Challenges. You know, JENSA is a group of evaluators. So here I try to see this, how for any research, how do you evaluate or conduct research and methodology in view of gender geography. So in gender geography, you also conduct research and what learnings we have and challenges we face. This is the main objective of my study. First of all, come to the definition of geography. Geography broadly deals with interrelationship between land, people, and their environment in terms of time and space. In general, geography has 2 branches, but very broadly, that is physical and human. As you know, the people, land, people, that means the earth, or whatever the space, people and surrounding environment, obviously, and in terms of time and space. Then human geography deals mostly with the human and their interaction on this earth. Gender geography is part of human geography, studies gender relations, spatio-temporal variation of gender-related issues, effects of gender inequality of space, social and other resources. Also studies women activities and their role in navigating within social fabric as half of the population. So obviously, when we talk about people interaction and time and space, so half of the population, they have some unique character and they behave and interact differently. Today, I remember Professor Rosie Mojid Hassan. Here you see the picture. She is the pioneer in introducing gender geography in Bangladesh. I am remembering her from my core of my heart.
Hafizaji, maybe have yes. The full screen, please, the slideshow.
It is not. Oh, sorry. Why it is not yet? I did it. Okay.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry. The study purpose explores, I will not go line by line, just this is the evaluation. So as because we are doing evaluation, so this study, just I have collected some research, what I have conducted before. There are some basic research, some are some projects. So the evaluation, what we did and what methodology we used here. And this kind of methodology we use in gender geography as well. So here I am evaluating these researches or projects through gender geography perspective. Here main methodology is field observation, transect walking, questionnaire survey, FGD, KII, to collect all this primary data through gender geography. Here you know everything. We all are more or less know about this methodology. So here I want to give more emphasis, not my emphasis, I should say, give some more light on field observation and transect walking, because as a geographer, this is as a must for us. And we have to go to field, we observe and walk along the spaces where we are going to work and where is our subject. So though field observation and transect walking, researchers understand unique characteristics of that area. Because when you walk and observe, suppose you are walking through a neighborhood, you can see each and each household, they have their unique characteristics in organizing their things in space and utilizing it. So when you do this transect walking, then you get more very in-depth information. But again, it depends on the observation power of the evaluator or the researcher. Understand gender issues in geographical perspective and notice and whatever this kind of methodology, whether we can use it for any other new research or not. Here, as because I will give the example from Bangladesh, here I have given some preamble about Bangladesh. I will not go that detail. You can see the population density and how dense it is. Naturally, because population density is high, resource scarcity is high. Here I have, this is, you can see the map, the vulnerability. We have all kinds of natural disasters here, flood, drought, land, riverbank erosion, cyclone, salinity, landslide, everything is there in so small country and with so dense population. So as because we have so much vulnerability, we have huge problem. For natural vulnerability, you know, most vulnerable are women, and the vulnerable people, that means the children, elderly, disabled, this kind of people. So naturally problems are there, but even with the problem, we are progressing. Everywhere people are progressing. How we are making progresses and how the activities and how these women are reacting or acting on this here. This is the subject. You see here also some more, I will not go through. Now come to the projects or the research I am going to address. I have selected only 5 projects here to show you how geography and gender geography is here. Here I have selected 2 cases on riverine area, 2 cases in forest area, and 1 is on health issue. This is irrespective of any area, but this is focus is on Dhaka. So case 1 is a woman out migration as a survival strategy from Chor land. And next one, a Chor livelihood program. And third one is two eco park projects, and Chittagong Hill Tracks Rural Development Project. And last one, the eclampsia, a result of neglected motherhood. So this mother, they bring life in this world, but for negligency, they fell into eclampsia. So if you give attention, you can overcome that or reduce the casualty. This is my objective or I'm going to address. The first one come to, as Bangladesh is a delta, we are the riverine one. You see Bangladesh, actually we say that Bangladesh has formed mainly through 3 main rivers, Ganges, Jamuna and Brahmaputra, Ganges, Podda and Meghna. Jamuna, Podda and Meghna. I have selected three chores. Chores are the island on the river. So chores, you see, here is a geography. These all are chores, but they have some unique character. And rivers, Jamuna is a braided river. Podda and Meghna are the meandering river. Here you see the north one, it is beside the Jamuna. This is the chore. This is beside the mainland. This is not totally detached, but not totally attached to the mainland. But the middle one, it is attached with the mainland, but it is on Podda. But the down one, this is on in Meghna, this is the near the estuary. This is the most vulnerable, physically most vulnerable chore. This is totally detached. And every year they have natural calamities. These chore are characterized with so many natural calamities. Through dynamic process, they face various kinds of problems. And women here, the all kinds of gendered oppressions are more prominent here than the plain land. You know, when this area is a remote area, the vulnerability for women are more always. It is not only in Bangladesh, not only in Chor. If you go to the hill area, if you go in any remote area, this is more or less common character. They have distinct gender dimension in management, certainly as because they are deprived, but they are the home manager. They have to survive. So there are some distinct characteristics to how do they manage. This out migration is one of them. So how they out migrate from this chore to make their livelihood and from their family. But again, it varies. This is geography. It varies from within this chore, you will find different character. So why they go out? Main factors are push. Push from the origin. You see this, the pictures, right? They all these houses are eroded, their lands are eroded for riverbank erosion. And then in the chore, with flood, they have washed, the flood washed their everything. So they cannot survive. And then other way, for their survival, industrialization, urbanization, other facilities attract them to go out. But it is not so easy to go out. And go out and how they will go and where they will go, it is very difficult. But again, the people take the risk, and these women, the brave women, they took the decision and then have gone. This is my study. Out of all migrants from this chore, I found 17% are women, and the rest 83% are men. And out of this 17%, 90% are female-headed household. That means they are heading household and they have to feed and take care. And rest are not the head, but the female member. So among all the, you know, the female members, 41% choose big cities. An interesting thing, the next portion, that means the 25%, they didn't choose the next small city, they choose the next village. Again, this is characterized by the chore. These ladies, the women, they choose the next village, which is attached to the mainland. This is easy to go. They cannot go beyond that, or they do not have the opportunity. And next one is the big city, and 14% has gone to abroad. And then the remittance from all the migrants, irrespective of male or female, had a very, you know, big contribution in developing the chore. To your livelihood or your people. Again, geography is here. These women, the prioritization where they will go depends on the place of origin. You see, the most vulnerable area in the south, I mentioned Meghna. These people, they migrated long distance. They took risk. They went abroad as well as big cities. An interesting thing, they have the highest literacy among all. Physically, this is vulnerable, but socially, they are very strong. So even it varies from one area to area, you will find the differences, and with time as well, because they have been literate for a long time compared to the other chores. As they are econ, they are accessibility is the big opportunity. It is near to Chittagong port, near to other cities. And they can go, if they cross the river, other big cities are very nearby to them. So they have the history and anthropological history I mentioned in host area. They made them brave, or the social bondage or social encouragement was there to go out. So employment in garments industry was the most popular one, and some other jobs are there too. And they used to get this through social networking. And these remittances, of course, elevated their family status. They mostly bought houses or repaired the houses, bought livestock, land, or something like that. And certainly they donated money to the poor. Interesting, whatever they're earning, what is from that, they donate some money to their poor relatives or the neighbors, mostly to poor women. And they also contribute in the mosque. Why mosque? To get the social empowerment in the community and the decision making. Here on the right, you see one lady, she has established this, shop, and she is conducting a family, small business. In the most of the garments workers are unmarried girls, and most of them work for and spend most of their money for the family with no recognition. And you see the households, head of the households of the Meghna Chor, I mentioned that the Chor who are most vulnerable, and all the year around they are in physically distressed condition. But even the girls from here, the families are proud of their girl because these girls take care of them and they earn and send money. And interesting, but the other chores, those parents are a bit ashamed because that society is conservative. They feel they are having girls' income, not boys' income. But here, the girls are doing and parents are happy and proud of it. And then in contrast to males, it's interesting, the females, they are continuing supporting their families even after they get married. But the males nowadays, the young males, they do not do that much what the girls are doing. Now come to the next research one, that is Chor Livelihood Program. This is a program funded by AusAid and UKAID. And this is mainly through develops the Chor land people and give them some support for physically improve their living condition and as well as training. So they have some, savings program. Savings program, they save their money, and from that money, they also take loan. And then by taking loan as well as training, they improve themselves. And here I have made some example from Bogra, a girl named Kajol. She has literacy level up to class level 8. And she is, she is conducting meeting. You see, they meet twice a month and collect money. And from this money, they also doing, they take loan and business. And she, Kajol and her husband, they took training on sewing. And they bought the sewing machine. Like this is the example and case I'm placing. There are some others too. And they are having their good livelihood and they're sending their daughters to school. The plinth level has risen because from this project, they train them how to do this. They know it, but again, this project helped them. The plinth and houses are managed and maintained by women as well. Interesting thing, not only the house or training or income, side by side with the male, they also do the other thing, but they fight against robbery as well as they fight against some social, problems or multifarious problems they face together. Because this, situation brought them together or broke the social taboo to go forward and work together. And they are more empowered now. And they need good road accessibility to sell their product, what they are making more compared to before, from agriculture as well as other. Now come to the third one. That is, I'm talking about Eco Park project. This is two projects you see in the map, in the middle as well as in the right, that means in the east. In the middle, it is Tangai, Madhupur area. And in the right, it is Silet, Molubajar. This is a forest area. Most of these people of this forest area are the small ethnic communities or tribal people. Here in Madhupur, they're mostly the Garos or Mandi people. This is a matriarchal community. That means the women are the own landowner. Government, as because the forest area, government, has land, government took numbers of projects, you see, national park, they established national park, later on agricultural farm, later on firing range, of Air Force, then Rubber Garden, and then finally National Eco Park. In some cases overlapping, some cases added some land as well. When they made this eco park, and naturally they had some, they displaced some people, and some people were not displaced, but they had to live up their, you know, livelihood because they were cultivating this land or collecting the resources from the forest. And this, the forest resources they have been enjoying for generations, and this is their livelihood, their culture, their everything is attached to it, and this is part of their life. So they are deprived of this. And on the other hand, the establishment of eco park in Madhukundo in the Silet, on the, you see the eastern corner, this is a bit more hilly area. There is a big waterfall here. So waterfall is a big attraction for eco park. So government, with the establishment of eco park, government added some other facilities. Naturally, the tourists are increasing and tourists are encouraged to go with added facilities. So this, the women are the worst sufferer as physical identity, as well home manager. Because you see, their feature is a bit different, their dress are a bit different, and they use the same resource. This is the, they use the water resource, and they work for home as well as field. So when the outsider come, these women, if they are in really, really in trouble. And they face harassment from the outsiders. You see in the picture in the right, this is in Madhupur. This lady, she is collecting some resources from the root of this forest. This is, maybe she is collecting some food or some medicine, because this is part of her life, not only her, whole villagers. So that is my question. When we take some project, we should be careful about it. And here it is not given that much. And when it came to notice, it was too late. Many villages were abandoned, and the tribal people lost their access to and restricted to perform their livelihood activities related to forest. Naturally, government developed eco park, they build watchtower, rest house, picnic spot, digging of artificial lakes. SSC people are thus affected in terms of losing land and livelihood and experiencing harassment from visitors. As because they are, this is lake, original lake they used to use for their washing, clothing, bathing, everything. But now they are restricted from their own resource, where they will go and how they will, and what is the arrangement. All restriction goes to them, but not to the visitors. Because when you are giving this one, so this, you see, this is geography, I mean, where, this is the remote area, the specific group of people and the women. So eco park, naturally they develop where the eco park can be, but geography is there. So this is not in the downstairs on or on the downfall or the other area. So when we develop something, we should keep some in mind where we are doing and what. An eco park project, you see, when they develop this project or rubber garden, they were promised that they will get job, but ultimately they didn't got that much job they were promised to. And villagers located within eco park are very much restricted. They cannot go out as their own. They cannot. But whatever they cultivate, even they, you know, they ginger or rice or cultivate, only cultivate, but they collect various kinds of resources from the village foresters. These are restricted. You see at the bottom, the villages located within beside the eco park of Madhupundo, that is in Silet I'm talking, cultivate betel leaf on forest trees. This is based, totally based on forest. So when the tourists come, they want to see the betel leaf. They say that when they touch the betel leaf, it get, you know, it, some insects, you know, they get infected. So they lose all these betel leaves, as well as they go inside their arena or inside their community. So all they are feel ashamed. And as you know, the people, tourists, all are not of same character or same type. So people, I talked to the ladies and they are really in trouble. And they are facing various kind of harassment. And now come to the fourth one, Chittagong Hill Tracks Project. This is totally an hilly area. And this project covers three district areas. The main object, this area is covered with 11 group of tribal people and also the mainland are there. So its objective is to develop the accessibility, education, health, all kind of. Main is infrastructure development to facilitate all. And then other activities as well. And here the target was mainly poor. And the women, obviously, as because the tribal people, these women are as well as workforce, as well as the home manager. And to facilitate the children to go to school, and mainly in the rainy season, you see in the right side, this is the hilly area. They live on the top of the hill. So in the rainy season, maybe in the regular time, it is like a small drain. But in the in rainy season or the flash flood, it flushes such a way that children cannot go to school. Or all of a sudden, this water comes. Not only children, the women, they cannot carry their product to the field. So here we made the transect work. You see the yellow color road. So we designed it and we said that, yeah, this road can be. And to do this, we had to go, walk, talk to the people, how they are using it. So we just, with the modern equipment, we cannot go and build it. We have to talk to them. We need to know their lifestyle, what they do, at what time they go out, what time they come back. They have some kind of, you know, own arrangement in the social system. So by understanding that, we have to make the design. And then as well as it should be blended with the modern one, with the project as well. Sub-project, they also provide, I mentioned about Shapchuri Parai village in Wagga Union. So they have to, it was the objective was that to make sure they have the access to the local urban areas as well as local market. And accessibility to the village and the main road, improve the literacy level of education, and then improve the economic condition of the villagers by facilitating market of their jhum as well as orchard product, agriculture forest product, and of course the others. Next, I will go. And this project also provided training. So training on what? The farmers on different technologies to improve quality and enhance their production. So technology, new seed, it established the linkage to collect, improve varieties of inputs like seed, pesticide, fertilizer, and their optimum utilization, how they can utilize optimally. And they made the linkage with the big market, chains of market. Also provide training to the local level NGO workers to develop a troop of skill manpower. There are numbers of NGOs because one project cannot cover everything. So that was the design that they will make a troop of, you know, skilled NGO worker who can work in the remote area and ultimately develop and give the new knowledge to the local people and facilitate them to link with the main market. And most of the ultimate beneficiaries are women as workforce as well as home manager. You know, in the hilly areas, the women work more than anybody else. And they are manager, home manager, as well as workforce. Now, come to the case of eclampsia. I already mentioned the eclampsia, the mothers who bring life in this society and in this world. But if they are neglected, most of the cases they are neglected in general. Nowadays, it is improved. But again, this, I'm talking about this one in 90s, about one research, and then what is the present condition. And during 90s, in 93, the average incidence of eclampsia among the obstetric patient in admitted in Dhaka Medical College Hospital was about 9%. And from them, 60% used to die at that time, I mentioned. This study was conducted in 1994. On the eclampsia patients, so we didn't do the all, just patients who admitted in Dhaka Medical College, because only in Dhaka Medical College hospital, gynae department has one small room, one unit as eclampsia unit, as because they need some special attention. So that's why this study was conducted on them. So from where they come, how they come, who are they, what are the problem, how many die, diet, these kind of things we analyze. And what is the transport, from where they come, this kind of thing. Here we found more than half of them got married before 18, and they got eclampsia at the first pregnancy, that is early marriage. Early marriage is the main cause, or maybe they were not given proper attention. Early marriage is the very big cause. And then during the period, next one. Mortality rate, both mother and baby, were higher in lower income group, and 40% of them did not get any antenatal care. Nothing, just stayed home, working hard at home, and then their socioeconomic condition and their health situation, sanitation condition was not good. But on the other hand, 25% were having antenatal care from a doctor. And you see, positive relation was found with education and income. Better education, higher income, they are better and survived. But with lower education, most of them died. And 60% were not referred, but rushed to hospital, but didn't know how to bring the patient to the hospital because they were not aware of it. Many cases, you see, they came by baby taxi. When they came by baby taxi, their alignment was like this. Not they couldn't keep this patient. They didn't know how to keep this patient. So when the eclampsia, the convulsion comes, and they, you know, they vomit, for the body alignment, the patient, she is unconscious. So she inhales that. This inhalation brings the respiratory problem. So she is not dying for the other pregnancy, but she is dying for respiratory problem because it is not known. And again, the distance from where she is coming. Dhaka Medical College, many patients came from the south of Dhaka by boat. So when they came by boat, the patient was in convulsion as well as she was unconscious. So same problem was with them. But contrary to that, some patient who came from Tangai, I think 200 kilometers away, but they came through ambulance, they survived because they referred by some doctor or they knew how to come. So distance, mode of transport, awareness, everything was related to their survival. The research strongly recognized to increase awareness along with medical and other logistic support to reduce the risk, and it worked. After that, not only this research, other research also, and awareness in the government, the media played a very, very big role in this respect, and the government took numbers of projects on it. And in nowadays, what happened? By now, advanced treatment and management has introduced in Bangladesh through initiative of Professor Latifa Shamsuddin in 1994. And by now, eclampsia unit is established in all the hospitals. You see, I want to bring how the women, they are sufferers, but they are also change the life. Professor Latifa Shamsuddin, here you can see her picture is hanged in the eclampsia ward in honor. And here is the Professor Latifa Shamsuddin. She is now 74. She is here. And you see, in honor of her, they'll hang because she initiated that. And now.
Dr. Khatun, really sorry to be interrupting, but you have 2 more minutes. Yeah.
Okay, 2 more minutes.
We would like to take some questions after this. Yeah, thank you.
Antenatal care has introduced in all the corners of the country, and they have the trained manpower. Here you see, just see the result. Between 2010, the maternal mortality decreased from 574 to 194 and reached 173 per 100,000 in 1917. So the maternal mortality decline, and eclampsia is causing only 24% of death. It was 60% before. And with appropriate initiative, the support and occurrence of eclampsia causality is being reduced. I want to say this example can be used for any other issues, but it is challenging to implement those in different geographical contexts. It is not so easy for everywhere. Next conclusion. Gender geography covers gender issues in relation to time and space, I already mentioned. And intervention based on evaluation on one geographical context appears to be not very successful, or in some cases fail to achieve social sustainability in other location. Maybe successful in one location, may not be other. However, if we can keep our objective and evaluation methodology, philosophically we keep it same, but customizes according to the need, according to the geographical location, I think we can get good result of research and some output as well. Not only research, we want to improve. Why we are doing research? We want to improve the community. We want to improve the society and people. So I think we can get the positive result. Impacts of same parameter have varied impact in different geographical area. Just like climate change is a very discussed topic. So climate change, we can evaluate. On the top of the hill, you have impact on climate change. In the coastal area you have, even in the plain land you have. So same methodology, but according to your location, your subject, you can use it. So there is a gender geography. So time, space, people. And you have to understand where you are and what time you are. Time is very important. Thank you very much for your patience hearing. And there are some references at the bottom, you will see. So I have just given some references, very small number, and some picture of some books. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Khatun. That was indeed very, very informative. Thank you so much for this, really. We would now like to take some comments and questions. I see the participants have been putting the questions regularly in the chat box. So may I request my colleague Kriti to take us through the questions? Kriti?
Shall I close it?
Yeah, you can close the presentation, ma'am.
Okay. So we have a few questions. The first question is related to COVID-19 and the pandemic. Mm-hmm. So how has the COVID-19 pandemic affected research using the gender geography approach and evaluation tools? How do we overcome field visits challenges of COVID-19 in different geographies from a gender and economic perspective?
Oh, thank you. It's very, pertinent question of the present time. Obviously, in COVID, we didn't go out that much. So most of the researches were, I should say, almost closed. But as we know, we are doing this kind of, seminar or lectures through, internet. So research are also getting, the internets are also getting more and more in this kind of research, I should say, than the physical one. But again, I think at least as a researcher, you should go at least once or twice to the field. Without going to the field, you cannot. Yes, in this COVID period, we could not go, but nowadays we go out. We go out, we make field visit, but not that much though in this COVID situation. Thank you.
So we have a couple of questions regarding the examples or the case studies that you shared. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So in regards to the char dwellers, do the women move together with the community or as individual families? And in relation to the eco park, have any measures been taken for conserving the social security of the women folks of the eco park?
Okay, thank you. For char dwellers, whatever we have seen, no, they didn't move together. They moved individually, but of course they had some neighbors. They got support from the male neighbors or relatives as well. Not only by themselves, I should say, but not as a team, because they use this connect network. Nowadays, you see mobile telephone number, through this mobile, they are connected distantly, remotely. So they have the network and they get confirmed or not confirmed, I should say, they get this, you know, the news or connection of job through their social networking and then go. And of course, sometimes they go in a group, especially the young girls. Yes, I agree. I should say the young girls, they go in a group and they live in a group in urban area. And of course they get support from the male persons, not only by themselves. And for eco, no. So far my knowledge goes, government didn't take that much, you know, that initiative to protect. But when some protest came up, and then government, it was initially it was totally fenced. They were not allowed to go inside the forest to collect any resources. But later on, they were allowed to go inside. Some, you know, facilities were provided, but not that much. Thank you. But here I should say for Eco Park, the local public representative, that means everywhere they are the elected public representative, they came forward. They talk for, you know, on behalf of these indigenous people or the tribal people. They made some progress, but not that much. It should be, to me, what should be, it was not that much. But some progress was made through public representative. They used, especially the Madhupkundo area in Silet, they could use this public representative. But in Madhupur, it was so scattered, so they could not be united to do that. Any more?
The next question is, how does the geography constitute the decisions related to legislations for specific gender? And how do policymakers support this idea? What challenges have been faced in this entire process?
Thank you. Actually, geography, the legislation, in terms of legislation, geography doesn't do that much. This is a common for the country. But yes, in terms of legal, I should say, like example I am giving about the inheritance property. It is not related to geography, it's related to religion. The Hindu or Muslim religion, they have one kind of inheritance law for the Hindu, the Christian. And then again, that the tribal people who are converted, suppose I was talking about this, the Garo or Mandi, they are, all the properties are owned by the female. But when they converted to Christian, they adopted the Christian method, you know, system, some cases. But in some places, they are practicing the traditional one. Same in Chittagong Hill Tracks, who are they were maybe traditional, you know, the Hindu, and they have the system. But after that, when they become the Christian, in some community, they adopted it. This is the legislation I'm talking about, the inheritance. But other legislation, it is common for the land, not for gender. And geographical perspective, yes, when government take any decision, they think about this location, but there is no legislative system that it should be like this or that. But yes, in the riverine area, you see, when the river bank erosion takes place and the land erodes, that it, when it again, become accredited, it become a khash land. Khash land means government properties. The government distribute this khash land to the landless people after a while as a guchho gram or the clustered village. In that case, they give priority to women, but not everywhere it is being practiced very nicely. But yes, as a policy, the women get priority. That is true. Here you can say some gender aspects are addressed. And again, the social safety program of the government, they are the gender of the women the old women and the widow or the family with the disabled children or some disabled people, they get priority. Yes, they have, the government has some program they give. A certain, of course, the NGOs mostly work with women.
So we'll take one more question. Could you please share a little bit about the KII method?
KII, okay. The key informant interview. So mainly the key, it depends on how do you identify the key informants. Suppose in a village you go, if you are doing some research related to some education or some other, naturally you will incline to the teachers or some literate persons. Of course, the students depends on that. So KII, you see, that depends on in anywhere you find some, depending on this, for school study, suppose I will take my example as well. Suppose village in the rural areas, the Chor areas. When we went to Chor, so we selected KII as identified. We tried to identify who made this, you know, move or who migrated, because it was very difficult to identify because migration has been going on for last 30, 40, 50 years. So where shall I stop? So in that case, with KII, we had to identify the local public representatives because they know, he knows or she knows the voter list. So as because he knows, so he or she knows who the people and who have migrated. And from him or her, we got this. He or she was one of our key informants. Another key informant was whether if we found some clustered household from where the numbers of people went. So certainly from there. And again, the school teachers, because they are school teachers, from the mosque, from the temple, where the preach were there. So they were the key informants. Again, if we want to go deep, depending on the other things, so depending on that, I do pick some other key informants as well. And these cases, when we take this interview, you have a thorough checklist with that. Make sure you have a thorough checklist, not just go and talk. If we do not have any checklist, you may not get all the information as you are looking. If some additional information comes through the interview, just pick it up and take it. But make sure whatever you are looking for, you are not missing that. So if we do not have checklist, you might miss that. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Khatun. So those are all the questions we have time for. If anyone has any further queries or questions for Dr. Khatun, you can contact her directly via email. Her email ID is provided in the chat box. I now hand over to Neha.
Thank you, Kriti. Can we do a quick poll to know your feedback for the session? Can we please have the poll question up?
We are experiencing some technical difficulties. The poll question cannot go up.
Okay. All right. So I'll just close. Thank you everyone for your time. We hope you enjoyed the session. In case you have not joined our network already, we request you to please join our network in the link provided in the chat box. We are 160 strong members and want to expand our membership. We welcome members from all the South Asian countries to be part of our task force and request you to please write to us in case you are interested. We work through volunteers and are urgently in need to expand our volunteer team. So please write to us. Also, don't forget to use Jensa Google Group to post events, resources, and your points of view. Please see chat for the details on how to do so. We are also updating our website where resources and member publications will soon be uploaded. If you would like to contribute any resource material on evaluation topics related to gender and equity, that you have created, please do write to us. We would like to develop a repository of resources from South Asia. Thank you once again from Team Gensa. Stay safe and stay well. Thank you.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And I had the opportunity to talk to the to you. But unfortunately, I couldn't know who are you, how many people and who are you. Maybe in future we will know to each other.
Thank you everyone for joining. Thank you, Dr. Khatun.
You are most welcome. It's my pleasure.